Good morning, everyone, and a very warm welcome to the worship of God, to this our united service here. Good to see everyone here. Welcome to any visitors who may be among us today. As usual, tea and coffee through in the large hall after the service. Do join us. Stay on for a time of fellowship together, particularly at this united service. It's good to have that fellowship over a cup of tea or coffee. We have the cafe-style service this evening, 6 o'clock through in the hall here, when we'll continue our series on the gifts of the Holy Spirit, and we're looking at the gift of healings this evening. All are welcome there. If you've never come to the cafe-style service before, why not give it a try this evening? Prayer meeting, 7 o'clock on Thursday. If you need a Zoom link, ask me for that. And next Sunday, 11th of February, the services are, as per the current schedule, 9:45 at Teviot, 11:15 at St. Mary's. And just a forward notice that next Sunday afternoon, 11th of February, we have the Connect group up at Meadshaw at 3 o'clock, when we're going to begin a new series looking at C.S. Lewis's Screwtape Letters. We're going to make sure that everyone that's coming has a book, so if you want to come, speak to me or Joe here, make sure that everyone has a Screwtape Letters, and then everything will be made clear to those who sign up for that or say they're going to come along, because a section of the book needs to be read each time, each meeting, which is about monthly, approximately, although the last one was at the end of January for various reasons. And finally, a reminder that the St. Mary's and Old Parish session meeting is on Tuesday night, 7 o'clock, in the small hall at Inverclough Street. So that's all the intimations. For a call to worship, we're thinking of the Word of God. This psalm speaks of the loveliness of the Word of God, some words from Psalm 19. So let's say these words together. The law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The decrees of the Lord are firm, and all of them are righteous. They are more precious than gold, than much pure gold. They are sweeter than honey from the honeycomb. By them your servant is warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. Amen. So let's sing now the Lord's faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great.
Join with all nature in
Let us pray. Lord God, our loving Father, we are so glad to be able to come before you together in worship. We exalt you. We give you all the praise and glory, for you are good and your love endures forever. Your mercies are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. However we may be feeling today, whatever we're going through, we come this morning from the week that has passed to offer you our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. For you are worthy of our worship. You alone are worthy of our worship. You are our God, and we will praise you. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We thank you, Father, for the brightness, loveliness, rightness, truth, reliability, and preciousness of your word, as the psalm says. May we find that to be so once more this morning as we listen to your word being read and preached and respond to it. Father, we ask as we come that you will take from us all that would keep us from you. In the quietness, we confess to you our sins of thought, word, and deed. Thank you, Father, for your promise that if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. May we know that in the depths of our being. Lord, we ask you now to bless this time of worship, fellowship, praise, prayer, and engagement with your word. May you be glorified. You have said that where you cause your name to be honored, there you will come and bless. May that be our experience, Lord, here today, we ask. All praise, thanks, glory, and honor and power be yours, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and always. We bring our prayers in Jesus' name and continue now in the prayer that he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Just a word of introduction to our Bible reading before we come to this chapter 10 of Revelation. Sandy's going to read for us in a moment. We've been hearing the trumpets sounding. We've heard six of them. And they're a warning to an unbelieving world. And they came in response to the prayers of God's people, especially those who have been martyred for their allegiance to Jesus Christ, who we heard calling out to God for justice back in chapter 6. As we've been discovering, the warning of the trumpets, the increasingly severe judgments they announce, were all designed to bring people back to God, back an unbelieving world back to God in repentance. Sadly, we saw last week that even after that sixth trumpet, bringing death to many in that vision, still people did not repent. So we've had six trumpets. Now we have an interlude, and the same thing happened with the seals, a series of seven seals. Between the sixth and seventh seal, there was an interlude. And in that interlude, between the sixth and seventh seals, we had a window on the security of believers in Christ and the glory to come. Lovely chapter 7. Well, here we have an interlude between the sixth and seventh trumpets. The seventh trumpet will usher in final judgment and reign of Christ. It's coming, his reign. We have an interlude now. It goes from chapter 10, verse 1, through to 11, verse 14. It is a new vision. distinct from the trumpets. They focused on the inhabitants of the earth, bringing these warnings, sounding like these trumpets blasting. Came to those who live without reference to God. But these chapters 10 and 11 focus on the church, on John and the church and their witness to the world, to all that God is bringing about in Christ. These chapters 10 and 11, numerically and in terms of their meaning, they conclude with the seventh trumpet. We know Handel's Messiah. The kingdoms of the world have become the kingdoms of his Lord, the Lord and of his Christ. That comes right in the middle of the Messiah. Very wise, because it's right in the middle of Revelation. These chapters 10 and 11 are a kind of hinge between the first half and the second half of this book. They connect the two halves. So with that introduction, just so we know where we are, Sandy's going to come and read these words from Revelation 10. Thanks, Sandy.
The reading this morning is from Revelation chapter 10. It can be found on page 1240 of the Pew Bible. Then I saw another mighty angel coming down from heaven. He was robed in a cloud with a rainbow above his head. His face was like the sun, and his legs were like fiery pillars. He was holding a little scroll which lay open in his hand. He planted his right foot on the sea and his left foot on the land, and he gave a loud shout like the roar of a lion. When he shouted, the voices of the seven thunders spoke. And when the seven thunders spoke, I was about to write, but I heard a voice from heaven say, "Seal up what the seven thunders have said, and do not write it down." Then the angel I had seen standing on the sea and on the land raised his right hand to heaven, and he swore by him who lives forever and ever, who created the heavens and all that is in them, the earth and all that is in it, and the sea and all that is in it, and said, "There will be no more delay, but in the days when the seventh angel is about to sound his trumpet, the mystery of God will be accomplished, just as he announced to his servants, the prophets." Then the voice that I had heard from heaven spoke to me once more, "Go, take the scroll that lies open in the hand of the angel who is standing on the sea and on the land." So I went to the angel and asked him to give me the little scroll. He said to me, "Take it and eat it. It will turn your stomach sour, but in your mouth it will be as sweet as honey." I took the little scroll from the angel's hand and ate it. It tasted as sweet as honey in my mouth, but when I had eaten it, my stomach turned sour. Then I was told, "You must prophesy again about many peoples, nations, languages, and kings." Amen.
Thank you, Sandy. So before we come to look further at God's word, we sing together a prayer for God to speak to us. Speak, O Lord. I'm going to go into the vestry briefly to get my glasses, which I've forgotten, just in case you think I've taken unwell or something like that. So let's sing this together. Speak, O Lord. Stand to sing.
Shape and fashion us.
us pray. We echo that prayer we have sung. We just say it again, Lord, speak, Lord. Your servants are listening. Open our hearts, our eyes, our ears, our hearts. Please speak deeply to us from your word. In your power we pray, Lord. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. At the start of that reading, Sandy brought us there from Revelation 10. We are given, that's page 1240 of the Pew Bible. It's good to follow on, particularly when we're dealing with these difficult to understand passages in Revelation. It's good to have the actual words in front of us there, page 1240, if we can have access to that. At the beginning of the reading, John is given this vision of this mighty angel. He's described in verses 1 to 3 in some detail. And he's not a fallen angel, like the ones who have heard in the trumpets falling from heaven, these demonic angels. This is a glorious angel. He is robed in a cloud, we're told. Well, God is described in Psalm 104 as making the clouds his chariot. The Messiah is seen by Daniel as coming in the clouds of heaven. A rainbow is above this angel's head. Well, back in Revelation 4, a rainbow encircled the throne of God. The angel's face is like the sun. So was the face of Christ, as he's described in Revelation chapter 1, verse 16. And his legs are like fiery pillars. We might think of the pillar of fire in Exodus that indicated God's presence with his people coming through the wilderness. This is a massive angel. So who is this angel holding the little scroll lying open in his hand? It's hard to avoid seeing him as anything other than the Lord Jesus Christ, isn't it? Given that description. We're not told that. We're not told that he's worshipped. But if he's not Jesus, he's a pretty good representation of him, isn't he? He's representing Jesus. This is speaking about the mighty power, glory, and majesty of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. His glory, splendor, power, mercy, presence, sovereign authority, and victory. You know, just having this picture here at this point in Revelation, when we've just been exposed to all these judgments that God is bringing about, the solemn reality of that judgment on those who reject him, and we've seen the persecution of those who follow Christ, those martyrs under the altar, crying out to God for justice. People round about us in ways that we are not aware of, in their consciences and their hearts and minds and experiences and sufferings through creation, through whatever it may be. And we don't know it and we don't see it, but it's happening. We still need to speak to them of Jesus. People desperately need to hear about Jesus. But God is speaking in ways that are... John is not allowed to communicate here, but it's happening. It's worth thinking about and an encouragement for us as we pray for those we love and others out of concern for their souls. So that was the mighty power and glory of God, our first heading. Next, the fulfillment and purposes, the fulfillment of the purposes of God. There's great encouragement in this today for us. The mighty angel swears an oath And he swears by God who lives forever and ever, who made everything, his eternity, his creative power. He swears by him, the one who made the cosmos, the one who is eternal, the one who is the only true and living God. He swears by him. So the declaration he's about to make has all the authority, his own authority and the authority of God, the Father, authority of God himself behind it. There will be no more delay, he says. There'll be no more delay. The end of the prophecy of Daniel. Daniel's given a vision of a great battle to come and leading up to the end of all things and issuing then an everlasting life of judgment. He's then told to seal up the words of that scroll until the time of the end, and he's told that what he's seen is for a future time. It's still to be. John is told there'll be no more delay. We live in the last days already between the ascension and second coming of Christ. These are the last days. The end is near. And once the seventh trumpet sounds, it will be game over. Listen to verse 7. But in the days when the seventh angel is about to sound his trumpet, that will come at the end of chapter 11 in Revelation. But in the days when the seventh angel is about to sound his trumpet, the mystery of God will be accomplished, just as he announced to his servants, the prophets. He made known to the Old Testament prophets and indeed to those whose words are recorded, prophetic words in the New Testament, speak about the final day of the Lord that is coming. Well, here it is. There'll be no more delay. The mystery of God will be accomplished. The mystery of God, by the way, is not some kind of spooky, mysterious thing, like a puzzle. In the New Testament, and the mystery of God is what he knew and what he has made known, a secret revealed by God. We could never work it out for ourselves, and he makes it known to us. That's what the gospel is like. We could never have worked it out for ourselves. It is revealed to us by God himself. The mystery is that secret revealed. All God is doing, all his purposes bringing about in Christ, his gospel purposes. Well, they're going to be accomplished, finished, fully completed. It's the same word Jesus uses on the cross. It is finished. It was done then. Now is going to come the time when it's all worked out and wrapped up and finished, completed, accomplished with the seventh trumpet, the coming of Christ in glory, the end of time, final judgment. It's also closely connected with the work of the gospel. It says, verse 7 there, just as he announced to his servants the prophets. The word announced there is the same word that euangelion it comes from, which means proclaiming the good news. Just as he effectively proclaimed the gospel to his servants the prophets. So this is the completion of the gospel work of Christ. Here's great encouragement for us as believers in Christ. That day is coming. The scoffers back in Peter's day said things just go on and on the way they always are. No, God is working his purposes out. That's a corrective we need to hear. The sovereign Lord has promised it in the strongest possible terms. It will come without any delay at just the right time. It could be today. There will be no more delay. The mystery of God will be accomplished. So be encouraged. Lift up your heads today to the coming King. Bow before him and adore him. We're going to sing that after the sermon. The mighty power and glory of God, the fulfillment of the purposes of God. Now we come to the last three verses. Four verses, 8 to 11. The sweet and sour message from God. The focus turns to this little scroll. Why is it a little scroll? Well, it's the same word basically that's used back in chapter 5 for the scroll, which was progressively unsealed, revealing these seven seals, these messages, what was happening, God's purposes through to the end of the age being revealed. That was, it was not said, it's not called the big scroll, but by contrast, the little scroll, it was a big scroll. Writing in both sides, a completeness to it. It was all of God's purposes being revealed from now through till then. This is described with a diminutive as a little scroll. A little scroll, a little book, but it'd be a scroll. So that suggests that it's got specific revelations on it for this particular stage. John is told to take the seal, to take the scroll from the angel's hand. In response, he asks the angel to give it to him. That's slightly different, isn't it? So on somebody's hand, take it just means take it. He says, give it to me. He wants the angel to give it to him. He wants to be a passive recipient almost. But then he's told again, take it. You know what that means? You need actively to make it your own. The danger, I suppose, of preaching and sermons is that we sit and we listen and it comes round us, and hopefully by a process of osmosis it comes into us. But the danger is we're not actively engaged in receiving that word. And this is further emphasized by the angel's command to eat it. And the word is literally devour it. Eat it down. Not just eat it, but take it completely. It's to become part of John. He has to make it completely his, becoming part of him. Remember somebody saying that to me as a young Christian, you need the word to become part of you. What helpful advice. It's not an academic exercise, it's interesting, I understand. No, there's a real engagement. That's why the Bible Society's aim for Bible engagement to increase is so right. This needs to be true too for our Bible reading and our engagement with God's Word. God's Word needs to become part of us. We need actively to drink it in, chew it, digest it, receive it, like John had to eat in that picture. You don't actually eat the scroll, but it's a picture of that taking and that message coming part of him. The hymn was saying, we come to the food of your word. It is food for our souls. C.S. Spurgeon says this, oh, that you and I might get into the very heart of the word of God and get that word into ourselves. As I have seen the silkworm eat into the leaf and consume it, so ought we to do with the word of the Lord. Not crawl over its surface, but eat right into it till we have taken it into our inmost parts. And the leaf's gone. Silkworm was bigger. He goes on to speak about John Bunyan, and he says, prick him anywhere, his blood is bibline. The very essence of the Bible flows from him. It become part of John Bunyan. Think of Pilgrim's Progress, the Word of God. The Word of God within us, by the power of the Holy Spirit, molds and shapes and changes us and directs us and corrects us and causes us to grow. Word and Holy Spirit together. Our minds, our wills, our actions, our speech, our everything is molded and transformed. Think of a bit of clay going into a mold and coming out as a face mask or something. We are molded in our lives by the Word of God. So we come to the reason for our heading here, the sweet and sour message from God. It might very well put you in mind of a Chinese dish that happens to be a favorite of mine. She sure doesn't need to ask me what I want from the Chinese carryout. It's always sweet and sour chicken. That isn't really very helpful as an image today, except for the fact that it's the combination of sweet and sour flavours that gives that dish its richness. Better think of the music of Johann Sebastian Bach, and our favourite of mine, perhaps especially in his cantatas, generally produced for use in a church service in a worship context. And you get very often, if you know the music, you'll know what I mean. There is this combination of joy and sadness, of sweetness and bitterness at the same time that gives the depth to the music and the communication of the message. That's very appropriate for Christian worship, because at the heart of our faith is the death of Christ for our sins and his mighty resurrection, suffering and glory. So see what happens when John eats the scroll. Remember, this is a picture language. He's told what will happen, and it does. He eats it. It's as sweet as honey in his mouth. Isn't that a lovely picture? Sweet as honey in his mouth. Here are life-giving, glorious words. Here is the loveliness and rightness and aptness and sweetness of God's word in all its aspects. Do you know that for yourself? It just is, isn't it? Whatever we're looking at, however difficult the passage is, it's God's word, and it has this delightfulness to us. The hymn says, "Who can tell the pleasure? Who recount the treasure by thy word imparted to the simple-hearted?" But once John has swallowed it and begun to digest it, what happens? His stomach turns sour. Jeremiah and Ezekiel had similar experiences to John, but they only had the sweetness, but then they too had to go on and communicate a hard and bitter message. Because this bitterness is because of the nature of the message itself, and the rebelliousness of those who are hearing it. Has to be hard things. The note of judgment in God's message is unavoidable if the communication of the message is to be true and faithful. We've seen that in the trumpets. The gospel is sweet. It tells of the loveliness of Christ, his saving work in all its glory and wonder. But it's also bitter. It tells of what we need to be saved from, the vileness of our sin, which separates us from God, damages and destroys lives and relationships and communities and our world. It's at the root of all these problems. It's vile. It separates us from God. God hates it. It will take us to hell. And we should loathe our sins. Jesus came, though, to take the horror of that sin on himself at the cross, so that all who trust in him, in the words of John chapter 3, verse 16, all who trust in him will not perish but have eternal life and all the fullness of life that Jesus comes to bring. Life with a capital L, now and for eternity. You see how in the message itself, even that most basic of gospel communication, there is sweetness and there is bitterness. That message needs to be proclaimed, and John was going to proclaim it. He needed to take the message as its, as his own, and it's true for us today. It's true for those who preach the word like me. It's true for all of us in our witnessing. Hear this. We need to be identified with this message ourselves. We're not some kind of agent that stands separate from it, and we have the message and we communicate it. We are involved. We have to be involved. We have to feel that message ourselves. John felt the bitterness in his belly as well as the sweetness in his mouth. He was experiencing the costliness of that communication. It needs to be lived, it needs to be real. Just a quick digression in that. Back in chapter 5, Jesus himself is given that scroll. The Lamb is given the scroll by God, and he opens the seals and the message is communicated. What is happening here is that John himself takes this little scroll, he takes it into himself, this sweet and bitter message, and he communicates it. We are becoming like Jesus in that communication, in the part we have to play. It is real and engaged. It is costly. I know that from experience. It is costly communicating this message, and so it should be, because it's real and eternal in its significance. Deeply challenging, costly, but we must remain faithful to God's message. I was thinking of an example. It's very contemporary, it's very controversial. Holding to the biblical view of sexuality and gender. Easy to say that, isn't it? But will you stand in that? So that when you're asked, or you're speaking of what God's view in this is, or if you're asked what your view is, will you draw back from that and say, well, I'm not quite sure of it. We can't do that. We need to be wise in the way we speak to people, circumspect in our communication, always wise as serpents, innocent as doves. We need to be loving towards others as we speak and relate to them, but we must also remain faithful to God's message in its sweetness and bitterness. Will we draw back because we might end up being, if it got out into the public domain that this is my view, I might end up being deplatformed or have access restricted in certain areas or find relationships cooled? That's just one small example. And it applies all the way through, even the being prepared to speak about judgment and the need for salvation. Thank you very much in the church today. A real danger is a truncated gospel. Do you know what I mean? Sounds okay when you're listening on the surface. Jesus is mentioned. But when you think more deeply about what's actually being said by the preacher or whoever, you discover there's not much mention as weeks go by of the cross, the need to trust in Christ and his saving death. In fact, there may not be any mention of salvation at all. You might even get the impression that people don't need to come to faith in Christ. The promises of God are extended to everyone irrespective of their response to Christ. You know that kind of thing? Is it just me? And that kind of universalism removes the bitterness from the message. You end up with a sweet message. But it's also moralistic, and it's all about making people's lives better. So there's quite a harsh edge to that kind of sweet thing as well, as it happens, but leave that aside. It truncates the gospel. It cuts the nerve cord of evangelism. It is damaging because it is not the full message in its sweetness and bitterness. We need to remain faithful to what God has said, even if others don't like it. And we do like to be liked, don't we? But we need to take our stand, knowing it's the Lord to whom our allegiance is given. And he will keep us. That's the whole message of Revelation. He will keep us and vindicate us as we stand for him. The Lord is on the throne. We're almost there. The last trumpet is about to sound. Soon to sound. No more delay. True for John and his vision. True for us today. And the last verse tells John, you must continue to prophesy too. And then there's this list that comes very often in Revelation. Many people, nations, languages, and kings. Note the breadth of that audience, not just God's people, not just inside the church, not just in your own friendship group, not just in your own society or culture, but to everyone, those who reign and thrones, those who go about their lives quite normally, those of every nation, those of every language, everyone, everywhere, God has no favors. This message is for everyone. You must prophesy about them, John is told. It's not an option. And the message is through from chapter 11 onwards, perhaps right to chapter 22, seems to be what this scroll contains, this little scroll. So you and I have our part to play in God's purposes. He's called us, like John, to take and eat this little scroll, to live the message, to speak the message faithfully. We'll see in chapter 11 next week that that applies to the whole church as we look at these strange things about the two witnesses. Applies to the whole church. We are called, you and me, by the Holy Spirit, each have our own part to play in these big purposes of God. Right here, right now, in all the details of our living, God calls us to play that part now. So what a great encouragement this vision in Revelation 10 is. I hope you have found it so. The mighty power and glory of God, we worship him. The fulfillment of the purposes of God is certain. So lift up your heads. The sweet and sour message from God, we receive it, live it, speak it. May God bless his word to our hearts. May he strengthen you and me through it today. Amen. So before we come to our prayers, let's sing that short song hymn, Lift Up Your Heads to the Coming King. We'll stand to sing. Come now to our prayers. And we were sad to learn of the death of two of our members, both on Monday the 29th of January. Bill Anderson of the Coppers, Roberton, died at home, age 87. Bill was a member of Teviot in Roberton, attended Roberton Church. The funeral will be at Roberton Church on Wednesday, 14th February, 11:30 a.m. and onward to the Borders Crematorium at 1 p.m. And then George Tate of 15 Beaconsfield Terrace died at home, aged 80. George is a member and former elder of St Mary's Knowe Parish Church. The funeral is yet to be arranged. We'll remember the families of Bill and George in our prayers. So let us pray. Lord God, our Father, we worship you as the eternal God who lives forever and who made everything there is. You are sovereign over all creation, over all things. We are so glad that you are working out your purposes through Jesus Christ, your Son, until the day soon to come when he returns to reign. You will certainly accomplish all you plan to do as you have promised. So we rejoice in you and give you all the glory. May we, like John, be faithful in living by and making known your word as it really is, in its sweetness and bitterness. We praise you for your perfect love and justice, and for the good news of Jesus Christ crucified and risen. At the cross, your wrath and mercy meet, bringing salvation to those who trust in him. May we not be diverted or deviate from your truth. Thank you that you keep us by your grace and your Holy Spirit. We know our weakness, but we look to you, Lord. Father, we continue to bring before you the mission in Hawick in May. Take hold of it, Lord, and have your hand firmly on it all the practicalities and planning, the work of sharing the gospel, the gatherings and the preaching, the relationships among the churches and Christians in the town and on the team. Please move by your Holy Spirit now and right on and through the whole event, and put your shield of protection over it all and us all and this place. We pray this, Father, for your glory in the salvation of many people, young and old. Sovereign Lord, as we hear of all that is happening in the Middle East with US missile attacks against Iran-linked targets in Iraq and Syria after the drone strike that killed these U.S. citizens. We have the continuing conflict in Israel and Gaza and the humanitarian crisis there, the situation with Yemen and the Red Sea, and so many other conflicts. It can overwhelm us and we don't know how to pray. We cry out to you, therefore, Sovereign Lord, to work out your purposes in all this, including for your people, that they will be faithful witnesses to Christ wherever they are. We ask that in your mercy, there may be an end to these conflicts in a just peace. And we pray, Lord, for Northern Ireland as the Assembly seems to be reconvening with a Sinn Féin First Minister. May there be wise and effective government and peace in Northern and Southern Ireland. But we pray especially for your church in Northern Ireland and the gospel witness there. Strengthen and then give grace and power to your people to be salt and light in that country for Jesus' sake. May there be that righteousness that alone exalts a nation. Father, we ask your blessing on our coming session meetings. St. Mary's Knowe Parish this week and Teviot Robertson the next. Lord, may we know, please, your vision, direction, and power in these challenging days for your church. Please provide the people and resources needed for your work, we earnestly ask. May our leaders be holy, full of faith, sensitive and obedient to you, and lead us on as we move towards the union of the three churches. Father, we pray for those among us unknown to us who are unwell in body or in mind, and also for their loved ones. Be at work by your grace, Lord, by your Holy Spirit's power, ministering your healing where that is your purpose, and giving the strength, courage, patience, and faith that are needed. And we pray for those who grieve the death of a loved one. We pray particularly for the family of Bill Anderson, his son Sydney and daughter-in-law Jill, and the whole family. Comfort them and draw them close to you, we ask. We pray too for the family of George Tate, for his wife Marion, for Rob and Paula, Gavin and Kirsty, Andrea and Darren and their families, and his sister Kay. We ask for your comfort for them and for the hope of the gospel to be theirs. And now, Father, in a moment of quiet, we bring our own concerns to you. Lord, please hear all our prayers as we bring them in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. So we close our service with him, "How Great Thou Art."
My soul.
Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord, strengthened by all he has brought to you in his word today. Let's say the grace together. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.